future, broadcasting on a satellite. Miss Maine is looking for an answer, watches your program every night.
Now, your album is called 11 from Kevin, and the Kevin in question is Kevin Gordon, who is a songwriter that you obviously admire greatly. So tell me about why you decided to make this record full of his songs.
Well, I used to go out and hear him play whenever he was playing, really, in East Nashville. And the first time that I heard him was at this hot little house party. No, I heard him first in 2012 at Americana Fest.
Right.
Which I imagine you've attended before.
I haven't attended, but I have a friend who goes all the time. We have a little of Americana Fest here in New Zealand now, believe it or not.
Oh, yeah, great. Yeah,
we have a place called the Tuning Fork that does one every year. So,
oh, you know who also probably plays Americana Fest out there is Jackie Bristow.
Oh, I know Jackie very well.
Yeah, I love Jackie.
She's got a new single coming out tomorrow. She's been emailing me about it also. Yeah, she's lovely.
Good. Well, I'm sorry I keep digressing. But
oh, that's all right.
Yeah, I saw... I saw Kevin at Americana Fest in 2012, and I thought I was seeing like Graham Parsons or something. I mean, his stuff really hit home for me. And we found out at this little house concert that a friend was having. I mean, it was like 100 degrees in that house. And it was 2013, and we found out we had an Iowa connection in common because I went to the University of Iowa. Right. But yep. Not in the rarefied air he was in. He was got his master's degree in poetry at the Writer's Workshop. Wow. But he played this song, Saint on a Chain. And I was just completely smitten with the song. And I'd loved it for years. And I would request it when I went out and heard him. But, you know, one time he was playing a record release party with David Olney, actually. God rest his soul. He just passed like a couple of days ago, a year ago, a couple days ago. Anyway, so he was doing this set and he was hawking this album. And I looked at it and I said, Saint on a Chain is not on here. And when you played it just now, I heard my band doing that song. Can I have at it if you're not going to record it? My goodness, how, you know, why are you recording this thing? So I recorded it in for my 2016 record, The Cardinal.
Every river's the daughter of the dirty rain. See how it shines. Water's moving like the blood pushing through my veins. But see how it shines. See how it shines. See how it shines like a saint on a chain.
I heard this song, I recorded it, and about, you know, April during the pandemic, I wanted something for my guys and me to do. And, you know, I was listening to Long Gone Time, this record by Kevin, and I went, somebody should do a whole record of this stuff. Mm-hmm. Should be somebody famous, but... I would love to do it.
Yep.
And I actually started doing it before I even called him. Uh-huh. I started transposing things into my own key and putting in, you know, guitar and learning my recording software. And I went over and had like this weird handoff of a PL20 broadcast microphone, like the one that Stevie Wonder used on all his stuff, you know.
Right.
And I took it home and I'm learning my software. So I made kind of guide tracks for everybody. And somewhere in the middle of that process, I called Kevin and I said, you know, somebody more famous should be doing this, but I'm doing this, you know, I'm just going to haul off and do it. And he said, well, I'm glad it's you. So, you know, I was really, because I'm such a fangirl,
very cool.
I'm such a fangirl. So
did you have any conversations with him about how you were going to approach the songs?
Well, I got lyric stuff from him. And he says, if you have any questions, you know, let me know. And we really dialed in the lyric thing and intent and all that stuff. But he didn't know how I was doing. I ran in when I was doing mixing after, you know, we got together safely. The guitar players are kind of symbiotic and play telepathically with one another, and they, since the 2000 2016 album, Chris Tench and Sergio Webb. They just have this thing when they're playing together that's really good. So we put a baffle up and everybody's wearing masks and the drum booth was separate. So we put guitars and drums down first. And my engineer has worked with me for a long time. We all had comorbidities and all that stuff. And so we really had to be careful. And then my friend Greg Boas here in LA, who used to be Smog Vomit back in the day with Tex and the Horseheads.
Okay.
And and he and I have been friends for 40 years.
Yep.
And he plays with me on solo stuff. So he's the bass player. And so he put the stuff on after the fact. We had a couple of little cameos from other people. So I'm mixing and I run into Kevin at the Kroger, at the grocery store. I mean, literally almost run into him at the end of an aisle.
Right.
And I said, Kevin, it's going so well, but I just want you to know, I'm not going to send it to you until after it's mastered.
Probably. Yeah.
Because I really want you to just enjoy it.
Cool. Know? And so what was his reaction?
Okay. He's so sweet. He's very sweet in all the ways. And he just says, okay. And he was really happy with it. So, and his co-writers have, except for Colin Linden. I don't know Colin Linden. I don't know how you say his name.
Right.
I don't know him.
Okay. All right. It's interesting because you have all sorts of affiliations with very diverse types of music. Obviously, there's this Americana-ish kind of thing. There's your association with Leonard Cohen, with the kind of post-punk LA scene with, X and the Flesh Eaters and Divine Horsemen and all that. So yeah. I'm really curious about the punk stuff and how you got involved with that scene.
Oh, I'm sure I was doing jazz at the time.
Really?
So I'm just kind of the Zelig of underground rock and roll. And and I was doing actually jazz with the people through whom I met Leonard Cohen.
Right.
In Austin, I was doing jazz with them.
Right.
And so I'm doing this kind of swing thing, red lipstick and hats. And Chris started coming out after the first way we met was Top Jimmy and the Rhythm Pigs were doing a country song on this compilation that John Doe was on. I think John Doe, that was the first time he recorded Wrecking Ball, from which occurred on Poor Little Critter on the Road, in the road. And some other stuff. And Chris said that he was smitten with me at the time. And so he offered me a spot on there. Well, I had this past of doing country and country rock from way back when I first started singing live, performing and making, some kind of pittance of a living at it. And so I said, well, let's do Almost Persuaded. So I did that. And that was the first time I played with Greg Lees, he's been on all my records.
Any record that has Greg Lees on it, I'm sold. He's
amazing. Oh, yeah. I said, I finally made a record without you. And I made the Cardinal. He says, and that's a good thing.
Fair enough.
I love Greg. So Chris and I started sparking and stuff while I was doing jazz. And, one night he finally got me over to his weird little house with the Mexican wrestling, lobby cards on the wall and as many records as you have back there, practically.
Oh, yeah.
And VHS tapes. And, well, maybe half as many. That's a pretty impressive record collection. He finally got me home and we were starting to smooch and stuff. And we hear this clanging and banging in the alley, beer cans clinking and stuff like that, and a bang on the door. And it's Doe and Dave Alvin, And they come in and we proceed to sing country songs all night long till the sun comes up. And then I leave, Alvin ran into me in the bank the next day, cowed and humbled. Evidently Chris called him up and read him the riot act, I just want you to know Chris is a really good guy. And
very cool.
I mean, Anyway, so that's how we met. And I've been, you know, friends with those guys since then, and X-Scene, and, not close friends. There's a thing about this tribe of which I'm kind of the zealot of underground rock and roll. I mean, Alejandro right. Escovedo, Chuck Prophet, you know, all those people, Peter Case from the Plimsolls.
You're mentioning all my favorite people. It's amazing. Well,
yeah.
Alejandro's been up here playing in my living room, actually.
Oh, great. Well, I did a big concert with him in 2000. I think it was 2015 or early 2016. I'm not sure. That was a big Leonard Cohen kind of, Leonard Cohen's influence kind right. of thing. And that was really great. And so it's like you have a card to this tribe. You know, and I'm a card carrying member.
Yep.
And Los Lobos would come to town for something at the City Winery or something. Steve Berlin would go to Dave Hidalgo. Like, oh, you know, you remember Julie from back in the day? Oh yeah, she's a really good singer and stuff. And it's like, I hadn't seen these guys for like 10 years, whatever it
is. And what's cool is back then, all that stuff was kind of in its own little niche, Leonard Cohen was one thing and X was another. And now it all kind of has kind of come together as one.
I tell you what, I think it was all kind of together then. And people don't realize that Steve Wynn, from the Paisley thing and Concrete Blonde from pop and X and Divine Horseman and Firehose and all of that stuff was together.
Yeah.
And now we're all in Americana because that's where we go out to pastures.
That's a good place to be. the grass is greener there.
A little calmer.
Yeah. So getting back to your album, there's a track called Glory Land, a song called Glory Land, which is kind of to me when I heard it, because I'm not that familiar with Kevin's songs myself. This is kind of my introduction to him. And it had a kind of a Dylan-y kind of serve somebody vibe to it. And I'm just wondering when you're listening to these songs and you're thinking about how you're going to sing them, what kind of process do you go through?
You might be the president, take a lot of power in your hands, bend the laws to your advantage, drive your armies to a foreign. You say your cause is just, lie only in your mask, just to keep on believing. Oh, they're on the way to glory land.
Well, I think I always have let the songs lead and how my voice can fit in the songs and my limited guitar ability kind of simplifies them. I mean, his band is sort of, this kind of splanky Louisiana funky thing, and people, I think of it more as a bar band in a way. And aren't really aware that they're listening to these fantastic songs from a poet laureate of East Nashville, who's been published in the Oxford American, so I was just Glory Land, I put the tremolo on the guitar and I started smashing it. And I think my guitar is still on Glory Land.
Okay.
There's only a couple cuts that it's still on. And I was just like, it really reminded me of that, the Divine Horseman stuff that we did.
Right.
And Divine Horseman, I told you, we're in the studio right now.
Yep. I saw that you guys are back kind of doing something together. It's fantastic.
Yeah. And we already put out one record.
Yep.
And it's just amazing to me that, how we crashed and burned 33 years ago. And here we are.
It's never
us and the guitar player are still the standing members.
Right. That's Chris D, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah,
Chris D,
yeah.
My ex, and Peter Andrus, who's just who's kick-ass guitar player, and DJ Bonebreak's been playing drums with us, and we have this great guy, Bobby Permanent. I'm sorry, that's what he's called.
Yeah.
Bobby Permanent is our bass player, and he's great.
So who's playing on your record on 11 from Kevin, other than your
guitar?
Well,
that's what I said. It's Sergio Webb on guitar. And he's fantastic. He used to play with David Olney, and he's got his own thing. And Chris Tench, who's just this amazing cat. I met him when I started recording things in Nashville. And my co-producer is Brett Stewart, which that's how I met Chris Tench, Ryan Stewart. And he has Wirebird Records, which I'm coming out on. Right. And that's it's a loose collective of people, including the people who did the David Olney record, Anana Kay and Irakli Gabriel, who did that Swan Song record. Uh-huh. And so I'm really proud to be in that company. And Chris Benelli played drums, and I had just met him because my regular drummer injured himself and couldn't be on it. And Greg Boas, like I said, from right.
So were you all in the same room playing together, or is it kind of one of these COVID things?
It was a COVID thing. I put all my guide guitar tracks so they could learn from that because they were in different keys than the Kevin Gordon versions. And then we got in the studio with in Brett's Wire Barn studio, which is really like a barn. And the guitar players played together with a baffle in between them. Everybody had masks, and I had already sung my vocals. Uh-huh. So I was sitting over in the corner, and, you know, I'd sung them to a click track so everybody could play. There was a separate drum booth that Chris Benelli was in. And then we sent all the tracks to Greg Boas out here in LA to play to. And, you know, I hope that you agree that this record certainly doesn't sound like we weren't all in the same room together.
No. That's why I had to ask. Because I assumed that you probably were thing. All over the place. But man, the technology is amazing these days. And a lot of other folks are getting that reaction. And it's just like,
right. Well, the thing is, the people who are coming out with records are people who are pros and have been doing this a while.
Yep, that's true.
But the youngins can't do this kind of stuff. Because they can't get the vibe going, you know, even when they're sequestered in their own little room.
Yep.
Because it's a muscle memory thing. Gotcha. You know, we can kick ass regardless.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
Now, one song I wanted to touch on was Good Night, Brownie Ford.
Near
the record, near the end of the record. And as I'm listening to it, I'm just wondering who this person is.
The old man's face, a map of scars. Straw Stetson brim, half Comanche. They called him Brownie for his Indian skin. I met him once in a cafe in my hometown, the corner singing Blackjack Day. Don't let the deal go down. We called him back.
Somebody was reviewing it and saying he was a real person, but I don't know if he's a real person. I never investigated that. I kind of want it shrouded in mystery, you know.
Yep.
I want him to be, you know, like someone that I've met. Like I met Barney Kessel one night in much the same way, you know. Right. And so that's, you know, that's kind of what I think of. And Karen, actually, who played piano, was over here last night sharing a pizza with me, and with the door open, and you know, and she is my dear friend and has been on my other records. She played piano on that too. That was our cameo on that one. And I just, you know, just that that thing of being so enamored with characters and music and being kind of a fly on the wall, you know, people who write songs and write, you know, I probably write more, you know, poetry and journaling and stuff than songs. You know, I just love that. I love that Kevin has such a panoply of different styles of things because, again, he's serving the song that he came up with. And I think I said this in my bio, which you must have gotten, that I really revere like Joe Ely and Bonnie Raitt and Ronstadt and people who have taken their friends and, you know, said, here, you know, you got to hear this. It's important. That you hear this.
Now, even though it's 11 from Kevin, there's actually kind of 12 songs because one of them.
Well, that's because I picked 11 songs and I went, oh, my God, I got to do Goodnight Brownie 4. I mean, I got to do Jimmy Reed is the King of Rock and Roll.
Right.
You know, another kind of homage to somebody that it's as if he met him, but it's more like he's stoned and he's listening.
Right.
You know, that Jimmy Reed is the backdrop for this, you know, you know, hungover story, you know.
Now your head is burning and your heart is yearning. Jimmy Reed is the king of rock and roll.
And I said, I got to do that song because it's East Dubuque and it's from his Iowa experience. And so then I realized that the Cry in Your Beer country song, which didn't start out that way, the heart's not in it. You know, that Kevin did it kind of straight ahead. And I went, well, dang, that's a country song.
Yeah.
So I feel like a country song.
There you go.
And it's in A flat and my version and Down to the Well is in E flat. So I figured out the math of making this segue into there and speeding it up a little bit. And I'm thinking about those two a lot right now, cause I'm making a long form video.
Oh, cool.
For them.
Very good. Very good. Now I have to tell you, we mentioned our kids and my daughter who is now 42, but you had a big influence when you appeared on Austin City Limits with Leonard Cohen. My daughter was like 8 or 9 years old, and it changed her life completely. We videotaped it off of XXI, and I still have it here. My wife at the time and I, we were like, oh, is this good that a kid so young is listening to Everybody Knows? And, you know,
my son watched
life completely. So I told her I was talking
taxi to driver when he was 13. So, you know, Martin Scorsese's mother would have let him do that because he was a filmmaker. You know, he had a camera's hand from when he could hold it.
Yep.
But I'm with you. That Terry Lacona always tells me that particular Austin City Limits is the most requested, played Austin City Limits that there ever was. And I'm really proud of that. We were all dead tired. We had played the Wiltern the night before.
He seemed to be totally on form. I mean, and you guys too, you and Perla. So, I mean.
And Joan of Arc, I got to sing Joan of Arc with him every night. And I think the cameraman kind of favored me a little bit because I was an Austin homegirl.
Right. Well, the two of you together strike quite a vision on either side of Leonard. I mean, he must have been in heaven.
He thought we were the Tony Orlando and Dawn.
There you go.
Folk rock or whatever.
And are you still in touch with Perla at all? I see she's still doing her thing, kind of.
She's actually in Ojai, where, you know, I lived for 20 years. And she's still, her husband has a restaurant there, and we're not in as much touch as we used to be.
Right.
It's almost like we're sisters rather than friends. It's like,
Gotcha.
You know, I just love her. And she has really made a business of doing the, and I don't say that, like it's just business, but she's the Leonard Cohen emissary.
Gotcha.
I chose to go a different way and write my own stuff and have my own bands and all that.
Cool. Well, it's just about to happen. It's going to come out in a couple of days. Well, it's Thursday here, so Fridays are just around the corner here, so it's very exciting. Thanks for taking time to talk to me about it and sharing.
Well, you're welcome. Thanks for letting me go all over the place during this interview. There's so much of my life that has gone into all my albums, but it's weird that it's sort of culminating in me doing covers of Kevin, you know.
Yep.
Not culminating. I'm going to make more records, and Divine Horseman is going to have stuff coming out. And, I'm not going to slow down.
Well, happy release day and happy birthday. And
thank you.
I hope everything goes well. Come on down and visit if you get a chance.
Yeah, I would love that. Helen, I think, still has a place down there. And Helen.
Exactly. I love everybody's version of the Kiwi accent. It's hilarious. Very good. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Have a great day.
Thank you. You too. Bye-bye.